Chavez Hauk from Salt Lake. So, of course, we'll all be putting out information on this, and we recommend you write your legislators and tell them that you are in favor of it. Voter registration, I am always going to be on the watch, and this with this bill, I'm going to be watching out for penalties for people who do voter registration drives. There was a horrible example for the 2012 election in Florida, and for the first time ever, the League of Women Voters stepped out of Florida because we were afraid that our volunteers would be charged with felonies. So as the same-day voter registration bill comes up, we might also be saddled with some voter registration penalties, and we'll be keeping an eye out for those to make sure that they don't impact regular citizens who do the work to make sure that everybody is registered to vote. Count My Vote. Has anybody heard about Count My Vote yet? Okay, we got a few folks here. Count My Vote is a citizens initiative that seeks to change the caucus system or the way candidates are chosen through the caucus system. It is a citizens initiative, and Utah is one of the hardest states to get a citizens initiative on the ballot. It requires that signatures be gathered of 10% of the number of voters who voted in the last presidential election. And that threshold has got to be reached in 26 of the 29 counties in Utah. This is going to be a huge effort. The League of Women Voters proudly endorses this effort, and we will work with anybody we can to get petitions circulated.
And I have a petition in my car, which I will bring in if anyone would like to sign it before they leave.
And I'm so glad to hear that. Now, the important thing to realize about any citizens initiative is when you sign the petition, you're not casting a vote for this. You are asking that this go up for the voters.
If I understand Count My Vote correctly, that's going to do away with caucuses, and all you'll have is just a primary.
No, not completely. Mass meetings will still be held. You will still have delegates. Delegates will still go to convention. They will still vote out a candidate. But when it comes to the primary election, that candidate who comes out of the Democratic convention or the Republican convention will have, say, an endorsement star next to them. This is who the party prefers. So it does not do away with the mass meetings. It just gives them less power in the ultimate choice of the candidates who are on the ballot.
Thank you.
Well, let's talk about the specific example of this holding up. Bob Bennett. Yeah. So Bob Bennett was beaten in convention. Mike Lee, Tim Bridgewater, they went on to a primary. Actually, if Count My Vote had passed by before that, Bob Bennett could get enough signatures to go on that primary ballot as well. So then that could have gone to the full Republican, because of course it's a closed primary, could have gone to the full Republican electorate in the primary voting, and they could have had Mike Lee, Tim Bridgewater, and Bob Bennett on there, and they could have selected from that. Because they didn't have that option, because this didn't pass, it was just whoever the convention put forward.
I'll also give another example. One of my personal favorites, Olene Walker. When Olene Walker went to convention, she had an 80% approval rating by the citizens of the state of Utah. She was ousted in convention. This is painful to me. This was our first elected, could have been our first elected female governor. And she had an 80% approval rating. So I'm going to hold to that. And Olene Walker actually stands for Count My Vote as well.
So how are we going to counter the argument that the opposition makes that only rich people are appealed to competing in the primary? So they're skewing the system.
Well, that's an interesting argument, because they're saying that only rich people, because they can buy TV ads. Do you really think that every state legislator is going to buy TV ads at all? There's not a market for most of them. The TV ads for the federal elections still exist. They're already there. They're already spending a lot of money. So the money argument is well out there, but the one thing I want to put forward is that when a candidate is running for office and they're trying to get out of convention, they will spend an average of $3,000 per delegate to win the delegate's vote. And their spending goes down dramatically. They only talk to the delegates at that point. And the argument is from the delegates, well, this is how I get to shake the hands of my representatives. No offense, you all deserve better than that. Your elected representatives should have to talk to you, and right now they don't. They've only got to talk to those, say, 70 delegates that are required to get them out of convention. So I think the money
it's not intuitive, it's not really clear.
Okay, well, let's make a different argument about it. One of the things that we see is the legislators, as a general rule, tend to be a bit more one way or the other, more conservative or more liberal than their electorate. Because even once they get in, an incumbent on the ballot is elected at a rate of over 50% once they get on the ballot as an incumbent. So when they get into office the first time, they still only need to talk to those 70 delegates because they still only need to get out of convention. And so this is much more than the money spent in an election. This is day to day, every day, and who are they listening to? If they don't need you to get them out of convention, why should they listen to you? And in this state, because of gerrymandering, districts are pretty well guaranteed. A Democratic district is going to get a Democratic representative. A Republican district is going to get a Republican representative. This doesn't fix everything. Gerrymandering has got to be dealt with.
The other part of that is if they can't afford to run as a primary, how are they going to afford to run in the actual campaign?
And also, anyone that argues that, and this doesn't necessarily answer the question of money in the primary, but anyone that thinks that there's not money spent in a convention needs to look at the financial filings of Dan Lillenquist and Senator Hatch from the last convention, because Hatch spent over $1 million. That was a convention ballot. So that was going specifically to just those delegates. So the argument that it's going to change a lot, I mean, all we're seeing is money is actually influencing every single aspect, regardless of whether it's convention or whether it's primary.
It's only people that are well off that getting elected in caucuses as well.
Right. This just comes down to money is always going to be an issue as long as Citizens United stands.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a whole other issue.
Don't we lack campaign finance laws?
Right, exactly. So I'll kind of move on from this. Please come see me if you've got any other questions about Count My Vote. Online petitions. This is a fear that I have. Online, as I mentioned, this is the hardest state to get a petition through. That's because we can't get online petitions. Signatures for online petitions are not yet legal. The Lieutenant Governor's Office, who was in charge of elections, said in the October meeting, that they were fine with online petitions. They would be perfectly happy to run with it. But the state legislature has to act on it. It would allow greater participation if it were easier to get an initiative ballot passed if we could do online signatures. So, who is law this one?
And I should say on online petitions, there is going to be a bill filed open about that. There's a Republican and a Democrat that are planning on sponsoring that, so that's good.
And it wasn't killed. 2 years ago, this came up, and it wasn't killed in its entirety. What it was done is it was set aside for study. So they said, take this. You have 2 years to study, bring back to one of the interim sessions just before the legislative session. The fact that there was an overwhelming endorsement by the group that studied it in the Lieutenant Governor's office at least gives us hope that it's not just completely dead law.
So law enforcement and safety, there are a couple of issues that are on the table this year. They're not always actually in time, so this is probably just a little bit of what we're sensing is going to be out there in a lot more. The first has to do with no-knock warrant reform. I don't know if any of you followed the case of Matthew David Stewart up in Ogden. A really sad story about an individual. The police came and raided his home. He had a very small amount of marijuana. He had some plants as well. Anyway, they came in sort of full military fashion. There's increasingly a lot of federal money being given to local law enforcement to invest in SWAT equipment and sort of militarized equipment and tactics. And are used in this fashion where they go and sort of beat down the door of somebody for, in this case, a very small amount of drugs. Probably not something that's necessary, and if anything, just created a further situation of violence. In the case of Matthew David Stewart, a police officer was shot in the course of this altercation, and so Matthew David Stewart ended up in jail and ultimately committed suicide. So really just a lot of destruction on all sides. One of the things that we've been working on with a sort of conservative libertarian group is working on some reform to our current statute dealing with no-knock warrants and requiring greater care on the part of law enforcement before they engage in this sort of no-knock warrant situation, that they have to sort of justify when they need to go in and not announce who they are, and that they have to really feel that there's some sort of aggravated circumstance, not just a small amount of marijuana in somebody's been much debate about the land on which our current Draper prison sits, because that land has turned out to be quite valuable for developers. And so there was a piece of legislation introduced last session requiring a commission to be put together to study the question of moving the prison. And as part of that study, they were required to go ahead and issue an RFP to developers and basically select a developer, basically sort of putting the cart before the horse. And without even deciding the question of whether we need to move the prison, already selecting the developer who would move the prison and redevelop the land. There was quite a bit of pushback from all sorts of different groups as this commission was meeting at various points over the past year. And so there's definitely been a slowdown on this question of whether the prison should be moved. And we really hope that it provides an opportunity for the state to take a look at the larger question of criminal justice reform. You know, if we are going to move our prison, maybe we could use a smaller prison. Maybe we could think of a lot of alternative alternatives that we could put in place to keep people out of prison, to use things like electronic monitoring or figuring out what is at the root of the reason that we continue to feed more and more people into prison and what we can do as a society to slow that growth down. Yes?
Is there a reason for the prison relocation dollars? Are they hoping to develop and get higher tax base?
That's what it sounds like, yeah. That's part of the RFP that's been put out, is actually specifically asking developers to talk about how the land would be redeveloped. So yeah, I think there is an idea that that land could be used for higher value.
I just have a question about Oregon and Colorado have legalized marijuana. Do you think that that's a possibility in Utah?
You know, I actually do. I know that sounds crazy, but I think it's, at least for municipal purposes, I think there's definitely some opportunity there. There have been a number of groups locally that have spoken out about the need for, in particular, the use of cannabis in treating young children with seizure disorders.
Autism.
Yes, exactly. So there are a lot of a lot of families here in Utah that are experiencing that sort of need. So I don't think that that is that far away. I honestly, somebody asked me the other day, which is going to happen first, gay marriage or legalizing marijuana? I think we're going to see them both in our lifetime for sure. I'm not sure. I think probably gay marriage maybe first, but I don't think legalization of marijuana is that far off either. I did see an interesting poll put out by a libertarian group of polling people in Utah about their feelings on that issue. And it was pretty interesting. People who fall within the LDS faith have a much harder time with that issue, with legalizing drugs at all, but feel definitely more comfortable when it's used for medicinal purposes, so I think that might be the first step.
Guns. Who doesn't love guns? Last year we saw a bunch of gun things again. Second Amendment Preservation Act, which is the one that we have up here, was a bill that was run by Representative Green from Utah County, from Pleasant Grove specifically, and it was essentially a Second Amendment Preservation Act saying that we were going to decide that as a state, because we love the Second Amendment so much, that anything that the federal government or any other laws that would impede the Second Amendment would be null and void here. There's a lot, obviously, you can imagine there's a lot of problems with that. I'm not saying that we don't agree with federal laws. Interestingly enough, it passed committee pretty resoundingly, and it passed the House. The House tends to be the place where crazy kind of bubbles up on the surface. The Senate, fortunately, cooler heads prevailed, and they just never got to it. So time ran out, which again goes back to our 45-day window, which sometimes it keeps crazy from happening, or at least less crazy. But there was another gun one last year that did pass. I don't know if you remember that it was what was his name? Mathis from Vernal. And it was a concealed carry, or essentially sort of termed the open carry. And it would allow you, if you had a weapon, that you could carry it concealed as long as it was not loaded. And here's the trick. Loaded just means not one in the chamber. So it actually means you can have a magazine. If your clip can be full, you're two steps away from a shot. There's a lot of problems with that. We have a really easy concealed carry permit process already. It's cheap, it's easy. We have tens of thousands of people that have passed this without any issue.
Even me.
Yeah, we're not taking it. So I actually know what's going
on. I'm not on a gun.
Are you panicking?
So it was unnecessary. That was the biggest consideration, is that we have this. It works. It's fine. And there were over 12,000 people, I think, over the last 9 or 10 years that had not been allowed to get concealed carry permits. Those people would now be able to carry with 2 steps away from being able to pull a trigger. So there were a lot of reasons to have to carry concealed. These are people who did not know whether they had arrest records, whether they had domestic violence issues. I mean, there's a whole list of things that keep you from being able to get a concealed carry permit. And this 12,000 Utahns were not allowed to get that because they had, one of those things. But with this bill, they would immediately be able to carry concealed. So it was just concerning in a lot of ways. It passed all the way through, despite a lot of very loud, I mean, we all spoke in committee, we had people writing letters, there were editorials, the editorial boards were against it. The governor even was against it. He came out and said, well, we have this, I'm not sure this is even necessary. And Herbert, if you watch him, he doesn't say a lot about anything. He vetoed it, fortunately. They